Jeff Davidson is a widely acclaimed professional speaker, mega author of 56 books, creator of 24 iPhone apps, and author of 230 ebooks for mobile readers. He holds the registered trademark as the work-life balance expert. Jeff has spoken to audiences across the US and around the world on the topic of having more breathing space, being more productive, and achieving work-life balance. Let's join Jeff now as he discusses how to make territory management more manageable.
This is Jeff Davidson with Making Territory Management Manageable. Do you know that sales professionals across the country and around the globe all strive for the same thing? They want to have optimal performance when they're actually out in the field calling on customers or clients. And why not? Competition is keen, resources are limited, and closing the sale has never been more important. Yet, I see time and time again sales forces that are not working optimally because of the way the work has been divvied up. In other words, too many sales forces are still relying on what's called geographic management. For example, take the state of Connecticut, where I'm from. There are 6 counties in that state. Suppose you had a sales force of 6 people. It might seem obvious to assign each of the 6 people one of the counties in Connecticut. Therefore, everybody would be a territory manager and having the responsibility for one county. That would save wear and tear on one's car and one's self because, theoretically, all of the good leads are within the same county. They're all in proximity, and you begin to understand the roads and the systems and how to get through the day most efficiently. But there's a major flaw in that approach. The major flaw in divvying up territory based on geography is that each of the salespeople would need to become a subject matter expert in a variety of industries. If I'm one of the 6 salespeople in Connecticut managing one of the counties of Connecticut, think for a moment, how many different lines of business would I encounter in the course of a day, a week, a month, or a year? It could be dozens upon dozens. Am I supposed to understand the banking industry as well as the baking industry? Am I supposed to understand insurance firms as well as engineering firms? Am I supposed to understand manufacturing outlets and wholesale distributors? Too much work. Too much time and energy devoted to getting up to speed in the various industries and professions one might encounter in the course of calling on a territory based on geography. So, you can guess what's coming. I strongly suggest that territories be divvied up based on line of business. Let's stick with the state of Connecticut for a moment. Still 6 counties, still the same land area, still the same population, still the same aggregate number of businesses that potentially my sales force can call upon. If I have 6 salespeople, same as before, and I want them to perform most efficiently, even though there'll be some greater travel potentially, I want to divvy up the territories based on line of business. So one of my salespeople, for example, becomes a pro in calling on the financial sector. And this could include insurance agents, brokers, realtors, financial counselors, mortgage bankers, anyone who deals with money and counsels others. And my salesperson who calls on this particular line of business, this particular industry, is going to get better and better at talking to the money people. And even if he or she has to travel a little more on any given day or in any given week, their expertise will quickly heighten as they call on one banker, followed by another banker, followed by an insurance agent, followed by another insurance agent. Pretty soon they begin to understand the needs and desires and hot buttons and trends of those in the money industry. Likewise, I have a second salesperson. This person perhaps calls on the manufacturers throughout the state, the factories, the distribution centers, the places where goods are made and shipped. By and by, this salesperson becomes an expert in the needs and the wants and the desires of entrepreneurs, managers, supervisors in manufacturing within the state of Connecticut. In a similar manner, I would assign to my other four salespeople major lines of business, divvied up by industry or profession, so that after a week, certainly a month, and certainly several months, they would begin to develop an expertise as they called on people in their lines of business. They would have increasing confidence. Why? With every call, they would get better and better. With every call, they would understand to a greater degree the problems and the challenges faced upon the next prospect and the next and the next. Each time they interact with clients and customers, prospects, and whoever else happens to be in the mix, they gain insider's understanding, and that is priceless. By comparison, the sales team that calls on territories based on geography and has to try the impossible task of mastering one line of business after another, sure, they know the roads, they know how to get from here to there faster, but they never develop the insider connection in the way that their sales counterparts can, who work for a firm or a boss or in a division that allows them to call upon a line of business. Even if they end up traveling a little more, and I'll explain in a second why that doesn't always happen, they're still more productive day after day, week after week, month after month. So, such a salesperson calling on a line of business, again, using the state of Connecticut as an example, could begin in a particular county, just like a territory manager by geography might approach the selling day. But the salesperson who's calling on lines of business in a particular county develops that insider's understanding while not putting too much wear and tear on his or her car, tires, and so on. The next day they could go to another county, another town, what have you. Any way you look at it, calling on businesses based on line of business ultimately is going to result in a greater percentage of sales closed, potentially higher ticket sales for each sales closed, a more rewarding day, week, month, and year for salespeople, greater ease in achieving quotas and sales targets, increasing confidence with each call, and the feeling that they are indeed serving that industry in major, major ways. Now, what else can sales managers and as well as sales professionals themselves do to make territory management more manageable? One, of course, is to collect evidence in advance. And I think this might be intuitive to many sales outfits, but the evidence I'm discussing may go a bit deeper. Anytime you have the potential to refer to a customer or client who you have previously served, you want to present evidence about how you serve that client, how they're benefiting today, what they've said about your product or service, and why they would highly recommend you. Now, you can do this in a variety of ways. Somebody could give you a testimonial letter. Somebody could make an entry on your blog. Somebody could make a Facebook or LinkedIn recommendation for you. Somebody could create a dialogue with you, which you record, and then you bring that CD or MP3 and play it on an iPod, on a mobile device. Perhaps one of your better clients or customers is willing to serve as a showcase client or customer. In other words, allowing you to come in with cameras, allowing you to do an extensive write-up, allowing you to take pictures to create artifacts that go above and beyond what the typical client might do. Then when you're calling on others, you can bring a notebook with you. You can show an entire run of pictures or a slideshow. You can have a mini case written up. You can have that person perhaps even be available on short notice by phone to sing your praises. These kinds of techniques separate you from the crowd. You're assembling evidence now for the next prospect you call on and the next that says, hey, I have served others in your line of business. They have benefited greatly from my product or service, whatever it happens to be. And I have some ideas on how I might be able to help you in your business as well. Who wouldn't want to listen to such information? Who wouldn't be favorably influenced as a result of that kind of evidence? So hereafter, you want to be on the lookout all the time for the kinds of evidence you can assemble. Too often as salespeople, what happens is we make a sale, we move on to who's next, and we forget about all that evidence we could have collected. When is the best time to assemble the evidence? When you're on site with the satisfied customer or client, when he or she sings your praises, whether it be over the phone, over the internet, over a mobile device. And the magic question you want to ask is, could I use your words? Could I use that exact phrase? Would you serve as a reference for me? Could I call you on occasion? Could I have prospective clients call you? If not, could I take photos? Could I show how my product or service works at your facility? Could I make you a partner, in essence, to help me serve others in the industry who don't necessarily compete head-on with you? Either they're not in the same town, not operating within the same trade radius, or perhaps offer a slightly different product or service to their customers and constituents. The point being is, your very best clients, to your utter amazement and surprise, very often are more than willing to serve as a showcase client, more than willing to present the evidence. I have to tell you, in my own profession as a speaker, having presented to nearly 800 groups now over more than two decades, I've assembled 975 letters, if you can believe it, 975 letters from different people from 46 states and 6 countries around the globe who had something positive to say about one of my presentations that they happened to attend. Over time, I separated those letters into industry. I separated them by date. I separated them by male and female. I separated them by states. I separated them by many different criterion. Scanned them all, put them on my website, and today have the opportunity to send a prospective client a URL link that specifically offers him or her a variety of these kudo letters based on whether it happens to be industry or date or state or what have you. In other words, I can send prospective clients exactly the throng of letters and evidence and things I want them to see just with a couple clicks. Now, in your own profession, you can begin to think of ways that you can assemble evidence so that you can quickly and easily influence clients, make working a territory so much more enjoyable. For example, if you travel by car from prospective client to prospective client, perhaps a 3-ring notebook can serve you best. You could have letter after letter, picture after picture, installation after installation in your notebook, perhaps in plastic sheets that the prospective client can flip through and easily see and easily understand. You could have the same kind of demonstration on a mobile device. You could have letters available. You could have even testimonials, MP3 testimonials of clients or customers who have said wonderful things about you and have much wisdom and insights to impart to the next parties you'll be calling on. I know over the years that when someone has asked me personally to serve as a recommendation for them and they have served me well, I'm only too happy to do it. So you want to assemble as much viable evidence as you possibly can before you go out into the field or before you get on the phone, before you make contact with prospective clients, so that as the conversation gets rolling, you have the opportunity to point to this evidence and make a dramatic impact right off the bat. Another technique that I highly recommend for making territory management manageable is to rehearse with lower level prospects. Let me explain what I mean by that. when you're breaking in a new salesperson or you're going out yourself into a territory for a first time, you don't want to call on your potentially most lucrative prospects. There's no reason to do that at the beginning, even though you may have a hankering to do so. You want to call on lower level prospects. In fact, you may even wish to call on prospects that, to your best calculation, really have little need for your product or service or represent a very small sale even if they were to come through. Why? If they're in the line of business that you've chosen to target, in other words, if they're in the right industry where you want to become an insider, simply making the call and simply understanding their situation is going to help you gather the type of insider information that will make you more valuable when you're ready to call on the more potentially lucrative customers or clients. So I say what you do is you burn three. Call on three prospects that, hey, if you close some business with them, you're happy, but if not, you still were able to forward your mission. After you've called on three, then think about the next three, perhaps a little higher order, perhaps a little more potential that you might call on. Work your way up to a position where you are so ready and so confident to call on the high potential clients that you've been drooling to call on, that by the time you get an appointment with them, you know you're going to make an impact. You may not make a sale that time. You may encounter resistance. All the things that happen in the world of selling are going to come up because you are so much more skilled. You're so much more knowledgeable. You're so much more an insider. They know you're a force to be dealt with. And even if they don't have a particular need for your product or service right now, they will remember you. They will save your card. They will put you in their file, their database file, or for those who still maintain a Rolodex or whatever system it happens to be. Because when you're able to talk to them in their language and make them understand that you know what they're up against, you show up like very few people they encounter that day, week, or month. Now, what else can you do besides burning your first three and maybe a second three to become an insider so that when you're out in the territory, you have a far better time of it? Well, I'm glad you asked. Here's a couple ideas you can initiate right at your desk. First, begin to subscribe to the publications that your targets subscribe to. Hey, it's one thing to subscribe to some good sales professional magazines, and I highly recommend that. But if you are calling on the banking industry, if you are calling on manufacturers, you want to determine the top two or three publications in those respective industries and begin subscribing to them yourself. Why? Because as you receive these monthly magazines and you scan through the articles, you look at the classified ads, you look at the letters to the editor, you look at some of the Q&As that might be there, the interviews, the features. Slowly but surely, you become immersed in the world of the people you wish to call upon. You begin to read some of the same articles and understand the same trends and the same challenges that they do. You begin to develop an understanding of their language, their jargon. You begin to understand the acronyms and abbreviations that they use so that by the time you're out there in front of them, once again, you're speaking to them in a way that few others possibly can. All you have to do is just identify the top two or three publications in the field. That's not too difficult. Anytime you're in the waiting room, in the line of business you're calling on, you're going to get clues. You can also go online and find circulation figures and subscription figures to publications and determine by popularity what the leading publications, journals, newsletters, magazines must be. And then subscribe. Go ahead. I don't care if it's $29.95 a year. I don't care if it's $129.95 a year. For the couple hundred dollars or less, you may be laying out in order to receive these publications, at the same time that your key targets are receiving them, You have made one of the wisest investments as a sales professional you can possibly make. Where else in this world are you going to get insider information coming to you in a timely manner, right to your desk? Then, of course, become familiar with the websites. All major publications today have a website that parallels the magazine. They may have different features. They may carry some of the same articles. You may be able to save them, download them, print them, mark them up, use them as you will. You may be able to find what's called hot button information in such articles. In other words, you're reading an article, whether online or from the publication you've received in the mail. You come across an article that has trend information or data or discusses what others in the field are doing. That just so happens to be a very critical piece of information that you want to present when you're on sales calls, because it confirms the value of acquiring your product or service. So you highlight it. You either print it out or you have it saved as a PDF. In other words, you have it accessible. So by reading what your targets read, you have put yourself in a position that you will be so much more valuable when you're out in the territory. You will feel at ease. You will be glad to make calls, because win or lose, whether the client, prospective client, is resistant or welcomes you with open arms, you will show that you are a force in this field. You know what you're talking about. You're worth listening to. And maybe not now, but at some time or another, the two of you probably ought to connect on a much higher level. So first is to read what your targets read. Next is to join what they join. What are the key trade, civic, and association groups that your targets belong to? Here again, as a sales professional, it's one thing to belong to the sales associations in your field. If you sell a particular type of good, if you offer a particular type of service, it's one thing to be in your capital city association, or it's one thing to be in your local trade association, but you're just hobnobbing with peers, other sales professionals. It's quite another matter altogether to plunk down your money to become a member of the associations that your targets belong to. Now, the associations that your targets belong to very often have what's called an associate member category. Some call it a vendor member category. Some simply call it something else. And often you pay a slightly higher fee because you are not someone in the business. You're someone who works with the business. But as with subscribing to what your key targets subscribe, the couple hundred dollars that you might shell out to become a member of these vital associations represents one of the better investments you can make in your life and in your career. Where else are you going to hobnob with the people that you want to be calling on? When they get to know you as a person, they see you at these events. And by the way, this doesn't happen overnight. By some studies, you have to go to events more than 9 times. But if it's monthly, if it's in your geographic area, if the right people are attending, if you're learning things, if you're getting a newsletter, if you're getting a membership directory, if you're once again understanding the hot button issues of the industry that you're calling on, then it is ultra, ultra valuable to join the associations that your targets join. What's more, you have the opportunity to begin to play a vital role within these associations. For example, you could volunteer to be on the welcoming committee so that every time there's a gathering, there's a monthly meeting, you're the one at the registration table, you're the greeter, you're the one who's shaking hands, you're the one who's checking people off, you're the face they see when they come in the door. That's a very valuable position. If the association is structured so that you may become an officer within it, that represents a tremendous strategy in terms of becoming an insider and hence enhancing your time when you're out in the territory. if you become known within that organization and truly serve that organization, then you have a leg up on all the other sales professionals who offer anything close to what you're offering when it's time to actually go greet the potential customers, the prospective clients and customers out in the field. So by all means, join what they join. Third in our triumvirate here, read what they read, join what they join, you want to attend what they attend. Are there national associations which, yes, could cost a lot of money for registration, plane flight, hotel, and so forth, but are there national conferences for which it makes sense for you to attend? Are there events that are bigger and more expensive, perhaps held in state or within the county, in the town, that represent a once a year kind of gathering, an annual gathering of an association, an exposition, something that might require you plunking down a couple hundred to attend? But once again, who else will be there if all the right people will be there? If your target market will be there in droves, then it makes perfect sense for you to plunk down that money and attend, because it only enhances your insider understanding and how good you're going to be when you get out in the field and these people see you again and say, oh yeah, aren't you a member of so-and-so? You bet I am. Now, as we move towards the close of this program, I want to reflect on where we've been and what else needs to be done. We've discussed the importance of approaching the territory by line of business instead of purely geography. We've also discussed how valuable it is to collect evidence, irrefutable evidence, as to the value of your product or service, and perhaps even to develop some showcase clients who are more than willing to serve as the best possible references you could have. We've also discussed subscribing to what your key targets subscribe to. In other words, reading what they read and collecting the hot button materials, the hot button articles, the key facts and data that support what you have to offer in meeting their business needs and finding solutions to their problems. We've discussed joining what they join and taking an active role in the associations and attending what they attend. One last item in making territory management more manageable, that is rehearsing. And I know the longer you've been in the field of selling, the bigger your groan was when you heard the word rehearsing. We think to ourselves, okay, I don't need to do this part. I'm a pro. I know what to say. I know how to think on my feet. I'm immersed in the field. I've become an insider. So why should I bother to rehearse? Well, do you know that the best speakers in the world, the best politicians, the best athletes, the best in any profession, rehearse, rehearse, rehearse. They don't have baseball spring training for nothing. The top Olympic skaters have their own coaches. The top gymnasts, the top in every profession recognizes the importance of being coached, of rehearsing in front of that coach, of practicing, and making sure that when they get out in front of the prospective client, they're going to be at their best. Now, do you have to rehearse in front of others? If you can, in front of a boss and in front of peers, that would be excellent. But if you only record your presentation into a pocket recorder and play it back, that would be worthwhile, because you can gain valuable feedback that you otherwise miss in the day-to-day, week-to-week scurrying about. So as often as you possibly can, even if you've given the presentation so many times, record it, play it back, and think if there's another way to say a particular sentence. Is there a word you can substitute for one you've been using? Would it be better if you used some pauses on occasion for dramatic effect? Would raising or lowering your voice make a difference? And so on. If you rehearse, even if you're a veteran, I guarantee that when you're out in the field, you're going to be more impactful. And that's when it really counts. So, following the advice in this program to make territory management more manageable, I think you're going to have a great quarter, a great year, and a great career. This is Jeff Davidson. Thanks for listening.
You've been listening to Jeff Davidson, mega author and professional speaker. For more information on Jeff's presentations, his books, and his other products, visit www.breathingspace.com. That's www.breathingspace.com.